Go into your room, that's right. Sit on that fat of yours and do nothing but listen to records.
I was going to make a video today about dry record brushing. I think it's an important subject because you really have to dry brush your records on a regular basis. And there's a technique involved that is good or bad. And there are multiple brushes on the market. So I was going to show you all the different brushes. And then I was going to actually drop a record on my floor, on my carpet, put it on a turntable with a good light and show you all the dust, and then take each of these brushes and clean them, and we'll all see how which ones are the best. That was the plan for today. I was going to show you the Audio Quest, the old carbon fiber tried and true. I was going to show you this one that is acoustic sound cells. I was going to show you this one that a gentleman in the UK makes, which is very effective actually, and the Ursa Major. And there's this one here, the Stasis Corporation, and this is the most beautiful one, no matter how effective it is. This is from Germany, and I was going to show you this. It's got a magnetized box. Very beautiful. That one, and this one from Furatech. And I'm not going to be doctrinaire about this. I'm not going to make a big issue of which is the best. You'll decide for yourself which is the best. But in the, so this morning, I get an email from a reader who says he went on this website, this YouTube channel, for InGroove. It's a used record dealer, new record dealer. It sells records. Usually it's a pretty reasonable site. And there's this absolute rant on there about Lacquers, how bad Lacquers are. And the reason why he did this rant is because of the Supersense program of selling people Lacquers that they cut from copies of master tapes. So Supersense is a retail store, actually. It's a combination of retail store, repository of all things analog, run by Florian Doc Caps. And I know the guy. I've been to Supersense. I've been to his store. And one of the first projects he did in this regard was Gregory Porter came into the store before he signed with Blue Note, and he cut a couple of songs, right there in the store in their little studio, all to analog tape. And it was released as a lacquer, and this is what it looks like. So if you buy one of these, and it's not inexpensive, you get a really nice box. I'll show you the box. This is the outside of the box. It says Live Recording Edition Number 1, Live at Supersense. And the presentation is like this. You get this package, and this is kind of what the new ones are going to be like, and you get this lacquer. It's nicely packaged too. It's in this metal device here. You unpack it. I'm not going to do it now because I don't want it to fall and then people will say that I'm ruining the lacquer, but that's what you get in any case. And you also get a complete it's really a detailed set of like mementos from the event. You get a picture of Gregory Porter taken with a Polaroid. And the reason why he uses a Polaroid, by the way, is this guy. This is the guy who reestablished Polaroid film, brought back Polaroid film, so you can use your Polaroid camera. See? You know, this is a Polaroid camera I got from a garage sale for $2 because nobody wanted it because there was no film. Now there's film for it. Anyway, that's what Florian Doc Caps did. That's one of the things he did. So he established this program with UMG, and UMG is giving him copies of master tapes. At first it said master tapes. And, you know, when I read that, I said, no, it's not master tapes. There's no way that UMG is giving this guy or anybody the actual master tape of Getz Gilberto to make runoff lacquer copies to sell to people. No, it's a copy of the master tape. And there's nothing wrong with using the copy of a master tape to do this. It'll still sound fantastic. Most of the great records that we love from the day, the original vinyl days, they were not cut from the master tapes. They were cut from a cutting master, an EQ'd cutting master. And we love those records and they sound great. Today, if you can cut a record from a master tape, you should do it rather than make it from a copy because it's a different world. And there's also the issue of one of the first ones they're doing is A Love Supreme. Now, the original master tape of A Love Supreme is not really usable to cut records because it has some technical issues, some glitches, some dropout, things that are not really great. So Rudy Van Gelder did find a copy that was sent to the UK shortly after the recording was made that's actually better. So that's what is being used today. And people complain it's not the master tape, but it's better. For this program, Supersense is getting the original master tape, the one that has the problems on it. And that's what he's using. So why this guy in Groove is complaining about that, I don't know. He's telling you that's what it is. It's got its problems, but for somebody who wants to hear the actual master tape cut on a lacquer, a copy of it, you can buy it. If you don't want to buy it, don't buy it. At any rate, the bigger issue here is that what Mr. Ingroove is saying about lacquers is absolutely ridiculous. He's saying, they turn to dust after a couple of plays. They're useless. You don't want these things. They chip. They break. You know, it's funny because that's what people say about vinyl records. These crazy people, you can stream this stuff for nothing. You can have a CD that sounds better, that doesn't have pops and clicks. Well, we know records sound better, but, you know, and they go on these rants online. These anti-vinyl people, they go on these rants. I can't remember if there is actually a website where people who don't like CDs, I don't go on rants against CDs. If you don't like, you like CDs, great. You like digital, great, fine, enjoy, whatever you like. But this guy at Ingroove went on this rant about lacquers. I don't know why he's so exercised about this. He thinks it's a ripoff. Well, listen, let me tell you something. Back in 1995, I was involved with MCA Records in a project called MCA's Heavy Vinyl Series. And this is one of the records. Maybe you know some of these. This is Buddy Holly, a wonderful record. And I wrote the liner notes, inside liner notes for this, for them. This is a project of MCA's then president, Doug Morris. And it wasn't successful because it was released just around the time that record stores were going away, or if they existed, they were not selling records, and there was not yet e-commerce online where you could just buy records and have them sent to you. So this was an unsuccessful project, but these were all cut, all analog, by Kevin Gray, who was then working at Future Disc. So as part of the program, I was sent test lacquers of all of these things. So here is the test lacquer cut by Kevin Gray of Buddy Holly. This is from July 17th, 1995. You see that? 1995. 2005, 2015, it's like a quarter century ago. I brought this lacquer to an event in Seattle 2 weeks ago and played it for people, and it blew their minds. It got applause. So here's what a lacquer from 25 years ago looks like. It's not chipped. It's not broken. It's not a pile of dust. Does it sound as good as it did 25 years ago? Probably not. Does it still sound fantastic? Well, you'll be the judge, because I'm going to put it on my turntable. I'm going to digitize it today, and I'm going to post it on this YouTube channel for you to hear. In fact, when I finish blabbering here, you'll be able to hear it. And that's only one of the things I'm going to put up there. The other thing I'm going to put up there for you is this. This is a lacquer of Tommy, of one side of Tommy, but cut at 45 RPM by Chris Bellman at Bernie Grundman Mastering. You'll notice, this is cut in 2006, you'll notice it's not a pile of dust. It's not falling apart. It doesn't cause toxic goiters or start world wars. And I've played this for people too. And in fact, I played it for somebody the other day, and I played it for Leif Johansson of Ortofon, who was here to listen to his new Verismo cartridge, and which you'll hear on this turntable. And it blew his cookies. Okay, it's from 2006, and I'm going to play it for you. So what I want you to know is, if you don't want to spend $400 on a lacquer, don't. If you do, do. If you think you're going to be getting a pile of dust, you're not. You're going to get something that sounds absolutely fantastic. Will it sound as fantastic in 20 years? Probably not. Will it sound absolutely fantastic in 20 years? Yeah, if you play it even regularly, it will sound fantastic. And I'm going to prove it to you right now, okay? I don't expect Mr. Ingroove, Mr. In whatever, to take down his video, which is not true. But you be the judge after you hear this, okay? Here we go. All right, so that's the lacquer from 1995 on the OMA turntable, the K3 that I reviewed in Stereophile in October. And this is Frank Schroeder's 3D printed aluminum tone arm. And this is the Verismo cartridge from Ortofon. That's what you're going to be hearing. And here we go. This is the 25-year-old plus 1995 lacquer that, as you've heard elsewhere, has turned to dust and is really unplayable and sounds, well, it's a waste of your money. If you had this, tell me what you think.
Without Peggy, my Peggy Sue. Oh, well, I love you, girlies. I love you, Peggy Sue. Peggy Sue, Peggy Sue. Oh, how my heart yearns for you. Oh, Peggy, my Peggy Sue. Oh, well, I love you, girlies. I love you, Peggy Sue. Peggy Sue, pretty, 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 pretty Peggy Sue. Oh, oh, Peggy, my Peggy Sue. Oh, well, I love you, gal, and I need you, Peggy Sue.
I love you, Peggy Sue, with a love so rare and true. Oh, Peggy, my Peggy Sue. I want you, Peggy Sue. Yes, I need you, Peggy Sue. I love you, Peggy Sue, with a love so rare and true. Oh, Peggy, my Peggy Sue. Oh, well, I love you, gal, and I want you, Peggy Sue. Oh, well, I love you, gal, and I want you.
Sucked! Pile of dust. Right? Okay. Okay, now up on the turntable is the Who lacquer. This is Tommy. It's at 45 RPM. It's from 2006. And by the way, over here is my little friend. That is the best record lifter that you can get. It's really, really beautifully made. And it lifts the stylus at the end of the record. Okay. So, here we go. When this is over, you tell me whether you would like to have this and pay like $450 to have this, sounding like this, played many times after 17 years, okay?
Ever since I was a young boy, I played the silver ball. From Soho down to Brighton, I must have played them all. But I ain't seen nothing like him in any amusement hall. That deaf, dumb, and blind kid sure plays a mean pinball. He stands like a statue, becomes part of the machine. Feeling all the bumpers, always plays clean. Plays by intuition, the digit counts as ball. That deaf, dumb, and blind kid sure plays a mean pinball. He's a pinball wizard, there has to be a twist. A pinball wizard's got such a supple wrist.
How do you think he does?
I don't know.
What makes him so good?
Ain't got no distractions, can't hear no buzzes and bells. Don't see no lights are flashing, plays by sense of smell. Always gets a replay, never seen him fall. That deaf, dumb, and blind kid sure plays a mean pinball. I thought I was the body table king, but I just handed my pinball crown to him. Disciples needed him, and he just does the rest. He's not crazy, flipping fingers, never seen him fall. That deaf, dumb, and blind kid sure plays a mean pinball.
To remove his inner blood. is happening in his head.
A pile of dust. A pile of dust, I tell you. Two other things I want to tell you. When that started, my preamp was in mono for the Buddy Holly, and so the sound will be in mono the first couple of seconds. And I'm leaving it in because I want you to know there's no chicanery here. There's no baloney. You heard the actual transcription of that lacquer, and it was in mono for the first few seconds. And the level was a little bit too high, and it clipped a couple of times. I'm leaving those in there, too. And then I lowered the level during the recording process, so it's not perfect. But that's not the point. The point of this is to show you that a cared-for lacquer played many, many, many times over 15 to 17 years can still sound incredible. And I don't think you've heard a better version of those tracks on Tommy, okay? And it's not because of this turntable. This turntable certainly is letting you hear what's on that lacquer. But if the lacquer was dust and destroyed, it would sound horrible on this turntable, right? All right. Case closed. Thank you.